In this video, we're going to be talking about hypothesis tests for mu. Which is the population mean. And just like creating a confidence interval for the population mean, you will find there are two different hypothesis tests that we can run for mu. Excuse me. And which test we run is going to depend on whether or not the population standard deviation is known. So let's first talk about our conditions that are necessary for inference. You will find that these are the same as the conditions that were necessary for computing a confidence interval. Same conditions apply when conducting a hypothesis test for mu. We need to have a simple random sample. We need to have information that X is normally distributed. Or we need a sample size of greater than or equal to 30. And then this last part isn't really a condition, it just tells you when to use which test. If sigma is known, that's when we're going to use the Z interval. We just talked about intervals. We're going to use the Z test, hypothesis test. And if sigma is unknown, then we will use the T test. Okay, so whether or not we know sigma is what determines which type of test we will use. Again, if sigma is known, then we can use the normal distribution to conduct our hypothesis test for mu, so that would be based on a z-score. If sigma is unknown, the x-bar actually more closely approximates a t distribution, unless the sample sizes are very large, so we would need to use the t test. Okay, so two different versions there. Now, in the previous video, when we talked about the process for conducting an hypothesis test, we're going to be using this process all throughout the sections where we're talking about conducting hypothesis tests. So that five-step process pretty well remains in place. When we get to the part about calculating the p-value, I will show you how to do it by hand, but for the most part, we will just be using the calculator, so I'll show you how to do both. So let's start by looking at an example. Here is an example with a glucose level for some horses. And it says we have a horse at a Colorado dude ranch, a Morgan horse. Over the past 8 weeks, a veterinarian took the following glucose readings from this horse. So these are glucose readings. And they're measured in milligrams per 100 milliliters. And what we have is we have 93, 88, 82, 105, 99, 110, 84, and 89. And it says the sample mean X bar is approximately 93.8. Let X be a random variable representing glucose readings taken from this horse. We may assume that X has a normal distribution. Whoops, sorry, can't see that. There we go. X has a normal distribution with a sigma, our population standard deviation of 12.5. The mean glucose level for horses should be, okay, so mean glucose level for horses should be mu is equal to 85. Milligrams per 100 milliliters. And that reference value comes from the Merck veterinary manual. Do these data indicate that this horse has an overall average glucose level higher than 85? So do these data indicate this horse has an overall average glucose level higher than 85. And we want to use alpha equals 0.05. Okay, so here's what we're doing. A lot of stuff going on here. Now, we're going to follow that five-step process. So in part A, where it we're looking at what's the null and alternate hypotheses, is usually what we do first, state null and alternate hypotheses and the level of significance we're using. So here, assuming that this horse has a perfectly normal average blood glucose level would mean that it would be following that value, that its population mean overall average glucose level is 85 milligrams per 100 milliliters, right? And that would represent a normal level for the horse. It is important when you're writing your null and alternate hypotheses to have both the symbol for the population parameter as well as the value that you're expecting here, and then you need to use the appropriate equal or inequality symbol in between. You really need to have both those pieces. Units, sometimes you'll see people include and sometimes you won't. So the units aren't really an essential part here, but you do have to have the symbol for the parameter, the numeric value, and then the appropriate symbol in between. Now, here for our alternate hypothesis, since we're testing for a glucose level higher than 85, that's what we're going to put in our alternate hypothesis. If there is enough evidence on the basis of this sample, that is what we will end up concluding, is that the horse has a higher glucose level than average. And that would be, of course, important because it could be indicative of diabetes, type 2 diabetes. And then our level of significance is 0.05, or if you want to express that in percent notation, it's 5%. Okay, so there's our null and alternate hypotheses. This is what we're testing. In part B, this is where we want to check our requirements, make sure that we actually have enough of the requirements met to be able to run the test. Okay, so we want to check requirements. Do we have a simple random sample, or at least a sample that's representative? It didn't actually say that these followed a simple random sample, but it did say over the past 8 weeks, the veterinarian took the following glucose readings from the horse. We're going to assume that this is a representative sample. So we'll go ahead and check that off. And then we need to know something about X being normally distributed, or we need to have a sample size of at least 30, which would be 30 blood tests. We don't have that, but we were told to assume that X follows a normal distribution, so we can check that off. So we meet our requirements for inference here. Then in the next part, we want to find or estimate the p-value. Now, if you're going to do this by hand, there is a formula in the textbook for doing this. You would first convert your x to z, using the formula z equals x bar minus mu divided by sigma over root n. You'll recognize that from the sampling distributions section where we talked about the sampling distribution for x bar. And then what you would do is you would calculate the probability associated with this z-score or higher, since we were testing higher. So again, I'll show you that process. In this case, we were told that our x-bar for those eight observations of the horse was 93.8. Our mean is 85 that we're testing to see if that seems like a reasonable value. Sigma is 12.5. over the square root of the sample size, which was 8. And then we would crunch that through to find the z-score, 93.8 minus 85 divided by 12.5 over the square root of 8. And that gives us a z-score of, if we round to two decimal places, approximately 1.99. And then since we're testing to see if this indicates that the horse has an overall average glucose level higher than 85, we want to know what's the probability of observing a z-score greater than that value. And this is back to stuff that we did when we talked about normal probabilities. We would plug that straight into normal CDF, 1.99 to 100, since we're going greater than. And plugging that into the calculator, we get 0.0233 about if we keep four places, which is what your book will do. So about 2%. Okay. Now that would be the process for doing this by hand. If you're going to do this in the calculator instead, you would need to decide, since we're estimating mu, are we using a z-test or a t-test? Okay. So since we're testing the mean, mu, and we know a value for sigma, we're going to use a z-test. Now in the calculator, here's what this would look like. We would go into stat, over to test, and your very first options are your z-test and t-test options. Okay, but we would want to select z-test. We have stats. The mu sub zero that it's asking for is what is the mean in your null hypothesis. That's what it wants to know here. And the mean from our null hypothesis was 85. So we would put that in, 85. Our sigma was 12.5. Our x bar was 93.8. Our n value was 8. And then here on this line, it's asking you, what did your alternate hypothesis look like? Did it have a not equal to, a less than, or a greater than? And ours had a greater than. And then once you get all that configured, you would calculate. If you had data rather than stats, you would, which we did have the data, so you could do it this way. You could put all your values into a list and set it up that way, but I'm not going to do that since we had all the information we needed for the summary stats. But once you get it all set up, then you press calculate, and you'll notice it gives you first what your alternate hypothesis looked like, mu is greater than 85. Here's that z-score that we just found, right? Right over here was 1.99. Here the calculator's telling us it's 1.99. And then here is our p-value, 0.023. I said 33 because I was rounding it there, but if you don't have the rounding error, it's about 0.0232. Also gives you your x-bar and your n. Okay, so regardless of whether you do this in the calculator or by hand, you're going to get that same p-value. And that is the thing that we're trying to find. That is what we need to conclude the test. Okay, so our p-value is approximately 0.0233 or 0.0232. Then, are we going to reject or fail to reject the null hypothesis? On the basis of that p-value. So basically, what we're saying is that this is the probability if the horse's, if the horse actually has a mean blood glucose level of 85 milligrams per 100 milliliters, we would only expect to observe a result like this with an average of 93.8 about 2% of the time. So that's pretty rare. That makes us think that this is a pretty unusual result, which calls into question the assumption that the mean is actually equal to 85. That may make us suspect that the mean is actually greater than 85. Okay. And the way that we determine that numerically is by comparing the p-value that we got to our alpha level. This was our preset level of significance. And essentially what we're saying is if we see something 5% or under, we're going to consider that an unusual value, an unusually low value, and we're going to reject the null hypothesis. So again, your mnemonic device here is if the P is low, the HO must go. So here, since our P-value of 0.0233 is less than our alpha level of 0.05, we reject the null hypothesis, right? If the p is low, if it's less than, the HO must go, we reject it. If the p-value is greater than our alpha level, we fail to reject the null hypothesis. Okay, so we're rejecting here. Now, the very last thing that you always want to do is you want to interpret this result in context. If you're going to go to the owner of this horse, you're not going to say to them, well, we ran a z-test and we found a p-value of 0.0233 that was lower than our 5% level of significance, so we rejected the null hypothesis. Right? That doesn't tell them anything about their horse. So we want to put this back into kind of a layperson's context. Now, usually when we're writing this interpretation, we start with a statement about our level of significance, simply because different levels of significance lead to different conclusions. So at the 5% level of significance, then we need to figure out what we actually just showed. Well, we rejected our null hypothesis, right? And our null hypothesis was that the horse was fine, that it had a mean blood glucose level of 85. If we reject that, what we end up concluding is this, that they have an overall average glucose level higher than 85. Okay, so at the 5% level of significance, there is sufficient evidence to indicate that this horse has an overall average blood glucose level higher than 85 milligrams per 100 milliliters, which again is not necessarily a good thing for the horse. It can be indicative of a blood sugar problem. Now, the only thing that would have differed had we not known sigma is we would have used a t-test. Okay, so z if sigma is known, t if sigma is unknown, but the rest of the process remains the same.